Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. Theo Hickmat here. All my friends call me Jason Zelda, singer, songwriter, Bible teacher, and today we're going to be doing something fun. I've been wanting to put this thing together for you guys for quite some time, but I needed the time to actually be able to do it. So I got a little bit of time. I'm going to try to squeeze this in. A lot of people who watch my videos are former members of cults. And when you were in the cult, they taught you songs. And these songs, from what I hear, since I've never been a member of these cults, I hear a lot of these songs were boring. I mean, boring, man. And then they gave you these songbook that had these funny pictures in the back. And stuff like that. You don't want to deal with that. So now you're free. You're out of the cult and you're free now. And you're wondering, some of you may be wondering, is there any music out there that's in a style that I like to listen to that brings glory to God? And the answer is yes. It's been around for quite some time. But a lot of people who are involved in cults are never introduced to this. And the really good music, for some reason, they stop playing this on the radio. When I was growing up, I was listening to rock and roll, and I would listen to pop music, and I never really got into rap and hip-hop, but every once in a while, there might be a song there that gets my attention, but that's not where I venture when it comes to music. I really enjoyed 80s rock and roll music, 80s pop music, that kind of thing. And then around 1980, I discovered contemporary Christian music. And what the contemporary Christian music was, is it was a musical style that I was used to listening to, but the lyrics were written by Christians in order to bring glory to the Lord and to edify the listener, to build up those that are listening, to build up Christians, to build us up in our faith. These songs dealt with a whole bunch of different topics and things, but they were in a whole bunch of different styles. Now, a lot of people today are not going to be able to relate with what I'm going to say next. I'm almost 50 years old. And when I was young, I remember when stores used to be closed on Sunday so people could go to church. The idea of that happening today, strange to people. But I remember a time when the Bible was more respected. I remember a time when this King James Bible was very respected among the people. Before these new Bible verses started flooding in and altering the Bible and changing people's perspective on the Word of God. But what I find is this. When I was growing up, if you wanted to hear a song, you couldn't go on the internet because there was no such thing. The average house didn't even have a computer, much less a cell phone. Those things were still way out in the future. So if you wanted to hear a song, you had to wait until it came on the radio and hope that the DJ will play it. You can call up and request a song, but you might be waiting 2 or 3 hours for him to play it or her to play it. But if they don't play it, you didn't hear it. The little Christian bookstore that we had a very, very small music section, and the majority of music that was played on the radio station, they didn't have there at the music store. So every day I would tune into that station. And I would listen to these artists, and this music comes in so many different styles. And since there was only one station playing it, they tried to play all the styles, which was great. So that was easy listening Christian music. There was Christian rock with groups like Mylon LeFevre and Broken Heart, Petra, Glad, DeGarmo and Key. There were praise singers like Sandy Patty and Keith Green. There were people who sung in many different styles, like Randy Stonehill and Steve Taylor and others like that. There was even Christian heavy metal with groups like Striper. Because we Christians understood that if somebody listens to, for instance, heavy metal, they're not going to tune into a station that's playing slow praise and worship music. Odds are they're not going to do it. But if you went to them with a heavy metal sounding song, but the lyrics were sung in a way to give glory to the Lord, you could reach that person. That's one of the ways I was reached when I was young. It was the music. And it's one of the things that kept me on the straight and narrow. I listened to the lyrics of those songs. And a lot of those lyrics were based on this King James Bible. In the early 80s, the New Bible versions didn't have this major influence over Christians and Christian churches and Christian thought and Christian radio like it does today. So you can imagine my heartbreak when I turned on the radio one day and the station had changed their format. No longer were they going to play contemporary Christian music from the 80s. They just began to phase it out. And because there still wasn't any internet, once they did that, we didn't have a way to hear our songs anymore. We were cut off. We were abandoned. We were left in the desert of musicality with no way to hear the songs that we love so much. Well, I want you to open your King James Bible to Psalms 150 because there is a happy ending to the story. The sun is starting to rise again, which is good. And I want to give you guys a gift. We're going to open up to Psalms 150 because I want you guys to see that the God of this King James Bible is a God that loves music. And there are some people who condemn Christians because of the kind of music they listen to. I don't do that. I don't find the Bible teaching nowhere that you're going to hell because you listen to Linda Ronstadt, or you listen to Skrillex, or you listen to Marvin Gaye or Billy Joel. I don't find that in here. We have freedom that is in Christ, and that is one thing I'm trying to tell people and teach people. You're out of the cult now. You are free. And if you've come to Jesus and you ask him to forgive you of your sins, you are free. You don't have to be bound by these old ways of thinking, old thoughts. You get in this book, you find out what this book teaches, and you stick within the parameters of this book. And what this book teaches you about music is pretty interesting. We have the freedom to worship God and have fun doing it. It's not supposed to be some boring standing there holding a songbook and everybody singing slow songs. That's not what this book's teaching. Let me show you what it says. And what we're going to do, we're going to open up to Psalms 150 in the King James Bible. And I'm going to read what it says. It's a short chapter, only six verses. Only six verses. And I'm going to describe for you what the instruments are that are mentioned here that we can praise the Lord with. It's going to surprise you. You're going to see how timeless this King James Bible is. Psalms 150. I'll put it up on the screen for those of you who don't have your King James Bible with you right now. It says, praise ye the Lord. Now, ye is the plural form of the word you. So that means everybody praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. What does that mean? Well, the sanctuary would be the church. Praise him in church. But the Bible also lets us know that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost. We can praise him within our sanctuary. We can use our sanctuary as the instrument of praise. Let's keep going. Praise him in the firmament of his power. What's a firmament? A firmament is the air around you, the space around you. He's telling you, praise him in the firmament of his power. Let your praises rise before him. Let it rise in power for his power. The Bible says God inhabits the praises in Psalms 22:3. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabiteth the praises of Israel. He inhabits our praise. When we praise him, he will draw near to us. But wait till you hear the instruments that he'd like us to praise him with. You're going to love this. Verse number 2, praise him for his mighty acts. Now, you're not going to learn what his mighty acts are until you break open this King James Bible and start reading it. And from his mighty acts of creating the universe, who created everything, by the way, according to the Bible? Jesus did. Jesus did. So when we sing our songs to praise, when we sing our songs of praise, you are to sing the songs to Jesus. I know in the cults they tell you don't sing of him. I want to show you what the Bible says. Okay? What does the Bible say? In John chapter 5, verse 21 to 23, this is what it says. For as the Father raiseth up the dead, and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. So the Father quickeneth, the Son quickeneth. They do the same things. Listen to what it says, verse 22. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment to the Son. So on judgment day, we're going to stand before Jesus, not the Father. And the Bible says we're going to stand before God on judgment day. The Bible just said here, the Father doesn't judge anyone. The Son does. So who does that make Jesus? If God's going to judge us in the end, and the Father says the Son's going to do the judging, that makes Jesus God. Look what it says here, verse 23. Let me start at verse 20. I want to keep it all together. I want to put it all together because I want you to get the whole package so you can see what it's saying. I want to start back at verse 21. For as the Father raiseth up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which sent him. This is telling us that if you honor the Father, you honor the Son equally. You bow your knee to the Father, you bow your knee to Jesus Christ. You worship the Father, you worship Jesus Christ the same way. You sing to the Father, you sing to Jesus too. The Bible says that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. And it tells you if you don't do it, God's not listening to you because you're not coming to him the way he said. You give equal praise and equal honor to both Father and Son. So there's no problem in singing songs to Jesus. Not according to the Bible. Not according to this book here. You can worship Jesus and sing songs to him the same way you worship the Father and sing songs to him. You can bow your knee to Jesus and praise him the same way you bow your knee to the Father and praise him. Now, here we go, guys. You guys ready? Praise him for his mighty acts. One of the mightiest acts he did for us was giving us the option to choose to have our sins forgiven by coming to Jesus Christ humbly and asking him to forgive us. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. You can't earn God's favor. I keep telling people this in video after video. The cults will tell you, you got to work for the group in order to earn God's favor. No. Forgiveness of sins is a gift from God and you don't earn gifts. Gifts are freely given. You don't earn gifts. And the Bible makes it clear, you're not going to earn God's favor no matter what you do, no matter how many good works you do. No, you're not going to earn it. He's offering it to you for free. And if you try to earn it, you're going to get rejected. It's just that simple. Our works don't mean anything to him. His work means everything to him. He wants us to accept the work he did for us. So if you want your sins forgiven, and we've all sinned, Jesus will forgive us. But he's the only one to have the authority to do it. You pray to the Father, you pray to Jesus, same way, because they get equal honor. And you pray to Jesus because he's the one that has the authority to forgive your sins. Come to him and ask him to forgive you. And now that you're forgiven, all the bad stuff you did in the past, it's gone. I want you to comprehend that. This book tells you about the grace of God. In the New Testament, it covers the grace of God. How much he cares about us and loves us humans, that even though we sinned against him, while we were yet sinners, he showed his love for us by dying for us. He didn't wait for us to get good. He died for us while we were yet sinners. Because he knew not everybody would reject him. And for the ones that would receive him, he's going to reward them. Now watch this. This is where it's really getting fun. We're still in verse 2. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Do you hear the lofty terms that are being used for God? He's wanting us to praise him in the greatest of ways. And what's one of the greatest ways to praise him? It's music. Now brace yourself, because God is about to tell you what instruments he likes to hear in praise. Are you ready for this? Oh, you're going to love this. You're going to love this. I know I do. I'm going to mention the instruments, and some of these instruments you may have never heard before, so I want to give you a definition of what these instruments mean. Verse number 3. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Okay, trumpets. We know trumpets. But I believe trumpets represents instruments that you bring to life by breathing into them. The trumpet is nothing sitting there on the shelf. But the moment you breathe into it, it comes to life. There's a number of instruments that come to life once you breathe into them. Brass instruments, woodwind instruments, they come to life when you enter the breath into them. He says, worship him with the trumpet. Next up, praise him with the psaltery. What is a psaltery? I have my paper here, and I'm going to get the definition here. It says psaltery, an ancient and medieval musical instrument like a dulcimer, but played by picking the strings with the fingers. So a psaltery are instruments that are played by picking the fingers on the strings. How many instruments fit that qualification? There's quite a few. Now look at what it says here. It says, praise him with the psaltery and harp. So notice they have both of these together, psaltery and harp. They have them together. And this is what I think, and I could be wrong. Okay, I could be wrong, but here's what I think is happening here. The psaltery, I think, represents string instruments that you play by picking the strings with your fingers, but they're often played while standing. While the harp is a stringed instrument that you pick with your fingers, but you play it while sitting. You see how organized this book is? One instrument you would tend to play while standing, and you pick the strings, like guitars, bass guitars, banjos, ukuleles, other stringed instruments that you play by picking the fingers while standing. Most times guitars are played while standing. And then you have the harp, which are stringed instruments that are played while sitting. And there's a bunch of instruments that are in the class of the harp. Let's see what else it says here. Praise him with the timbrel. What's a timbrel? This is the definition for a timbrel. Let me pull this up here. It says, timbrel, an instrument of music, a kind of drum, timbre, or timbret, which has been in use from the highest antiquity. The drums, the percussion instruments. So not only praise him with the trumpet, instruments you blow into, not only praise him with the psaltery, the stringed instrument that you pick, both standing and sitting. Now we're bringing the drums in. We're bringing the percussion in. Now this is going to get good, guys. There are so many percussion instruments in this world. And God's letting you know, hey, you want to praise me with those? Go for it. Let me hear it. It's going to get better. Look at what it says next. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Now, how many of you, when you were in the cult, were allowed to dance? Much less dance in your place of worship. What would happen to you if right in the middle of them singing with those songs with the funny picture in the back, you just broke out and started dancing before the Lord? What would they do to you? You'd probably have a big talk done to you. They'll pull you in the back and have a big talk with you about, what are you doing out there dancing? What's wrong with you? Drunk or something? No. The Bible tells you, you have the freedom before the God of this book, the King James Bible. You have the freedom before this God to dance. And he didn't say what kind of dance, did he? You want to do the boogie woogie? You do the boogie woogie. You do it before him. If you're doing it for him, there's nothing wrong with it. If you want to do it in your own private time, that's your own private time. He's talking about if you're going to praise him, he's letting you know you can praise him with all these instruments. And if you want to dance before him, you can dance before him too. There are plenty of stories in the King James Bible about people who dance before the Lord. Let's see what else it says here. It's going to get better. I'm telling you guys, it's going to get better. Because I got a present I want to give you guys. And it's going to be something that's going to stick with you for a long time. I'm working on 11 videos. I think it's going to come out to be about 11 videos. And it's going to be music. It's going to be good stuff. Stuff you've never heard before. And some of these songs are going to reach you right where you are. And going to change your life. Because that's what it did for me when I was growing up before they took our station away from us. Watch this. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments. Whoa. That just opened up a can, didn't it? How many stringed instruments are there out there? There are some preachers out there who preach against various different kinds of music.
Oh, we ain't going to allow that kind of music to be playing there. No, he coming in with these instruments. No, I'm not coming in with it. We're not going to have them. We're up there guitars and dancing around. I heard a preacher say that recently. Had some guy come in here. We invited them in to sing. And doggone it, they're up there on the stage. And they're playing these things. And he's dancing around.
And I'm like, what are you doing with Psalms 150 where it says to praise him with these instruments and dance? He booted them out of his church. For going up on the stage, singing praise to the Lord, playing instruments and dancing. He booted them out. I don't think the Lord booted them out. Because the Bible's telling you, you can praise the Lord doing these things. If you're doing it praising him, you're doing it praising him. I want you to see the freedom we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. The freedom that he died to give us. You can enjoy music, and this time it'll be music that you can sing, and it'll bring him glory, and it's in a whole bunch of different musical styles. I'm going to give it to you guys as a gift. If YouTube would allow me and not try to copyright strike me for some of these songs, I would think for some of these songs, since they're from the 80s and it's contemporary Christian music, I'm hoping their copyrights have run out and they're not going to try to hit me with a copyright strike. But I'm going to try to get this music up there for you guys because I'm really wanting you guys to enjoy this stuff because there's no radio station to play it anymore. 99% of the music I grew up listening to, you can't find on any radio station anymore. Look at what it says next. You want to talk about a book that is timeless? This King James Bible that's timeless. Look at the next word. It says, praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments and organs. Organs? This Psalms 150 passage was written thousands of years ago. What did they know about electronic keyboards? More than you think. The history that we're told of mankind in our schools is a disgrace. If you really believe that your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-granddad was a gorilla, an ape, or a monkey, something's wrong. Because why did the gorillas, apes, and monkeys stop giving birth to humans? If they're claiming that we came from them, why did they all of a sudden just stop and they go back to giving birth to gorillas, you know, apes, and monkeys again? No, we didn't come from the gorillas, apes, and monkeys. The history that we're told in our schools is a disgrace. The knowledge they had in the past would blow our minds. And a lot of that knowledge was lost. Lost. The King James Bible says here, praise him with the stringed instruments and organs. The Bible lets us know that this book, the Word of God, is not limited to time and space. This book predicts the future over and over and over and over again. If it can predict the future and tell us what's going to happen at the end of the world and what happens after the end of the world, then looking into the future and seeing that instruments are eventually going to become something so advanced that there would be one instrument that could duplicate the sounds of the rest. The Holy Spirit of God is not limited to time and space. He can see the whole spectrum. So for him to look down the road and see that there was going to come an instrument that could play all the other instruments by itself, it's no problem for him. And I want you to notice, it didn't say the organ. It says organs. Those that are in the class of organ. Electric keyboards, organs, synthesizers, electric music. Don't try to limit this book into a box. It doesn't limit itself to a box. It tells you what happened at the beginning, how everything started, what happens at the end, what happens after the end. It's all there. It is the box. You get in it, you can't go wrong. Don't go beyond the perimeters of the book when it comes to the faith. So it says organs. I'm going to take it at its word, organs. God says you can praise him with the organs, the electronic instruments. Wait till you see what happens when we do. Next up, praise him upon the loud cymbals. Okay, we got the percussion and the timbrels, and now, we have the cymbals. But he's not done. He's got one more he's adding to the list. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high-sounding cymbals. I think those would be, those who've ever been to the orchestra before, you would see the people that have these huge cymbals on their hands, and they slam them together. The high-sounding cymbals. Verse number 6, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. When you put all these instruments together, folks, do you know what you have? You have an orchestra. Stringed instruments, trumpets, percussion, cymbals, psalteries, string. I mean, it's all there. The Lord is opening up the door for you to worship him with the full vastness of the instruments. Now, are we supposed to play them softly and gently? Or does he give us the freedom that if we want to play him a soft song, we can play him a soft song. And if we want to play him a hard song, we can play him a hard and loud song. Again, I'm going to go back to the Word of God as I sort my notes out here. He gives us the freedom to worship him in a multitude of musical styles. Psalms 33:1-4 says, rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous, for praise is comely for the upright. Praise the Lord with harp, sing unto him with the psaltery and an instrument of 10 strings. Sing unto him a new song. Play skillfully with a loud noise. Play skillfully with a loud noise. What is it about us humans? When you're listening to the radio, and I'm listening to the radio, and all of a sudden a song comes on that we like, what's our natural reaction? Crank it up. Crank it up. Make it loud. The Lord is saying, play skillfully. Play it loud. Verse 4. For the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth. His words are right. And if he says play it, play it. If he says sing it, sing it. If he says use the instruments, use the instruments. And that's what I want to open up to you guys. There's a whole class of music that's not played anymore. And it's really hard to find a lot of it. And recently I came across a webpage where somebody took the time to divide the contemporary Christian music into years, starting in 1979 to 1980, 81, 82, 83. And what they did is they took little 15, 20, or 30 second clips of the songs that were popular in those years. It's not the whole song. It's just a little clip of the song. And this person must have been a former DJ because they knew just the right parts of the song to put in the clip. Now, I want you to think about something. Again, those of you who are young, you might not be able to relate with this. But if you've gone 30 years and you haven't heard your favorite songs in 30 years because there's no radio station that plays it, and then out of the blue, somebody plays a little 20-second clip of your song that you haven't heard in 30 years, you just wake up like, whoa, I ain't heard that song in 30 years. It moves you. That's what ended up happening to me about a couple of months ago. So what I did is I took that song collection, because the internet is pretty fickle. You can have a website up today and it could be gone tomorrow. And you could lose it again. So I'm like, well, these are just little clips. I have some music in my collection that I'm going to be adding to these clips. I'll add some more clips of songs that wasn't included in his list or her list. I don't know, it was a guy or girl to put it together. But this is what I'm doing. This is what I'm wanting to do for you. There are those of you who came out of the cults and they taught you songs. But those songs are being sung to the wrong God. Now that you've come out and you've come to Jesus and you ask for forgiveness of sins, now I want to introduce you to some music that you can sing that will bring him glory. And what happens, by the way, you've seen this list of instruments here. What happens when you have skilled players who have spent years mastering their art of their instrument, and Jesus comes into their life and changes them, cleans them up on the inside, and now they want to sing songs of praise to Jesus. They want to sing songs of praise to God the Father. They want to sing songs of praise to the Holy Spirit as a way of saying, thank you for forgiving me my sins. Thank you for what you've done for me. I want to use my talent and my gift to reach others. What does it sound like when you have people using their musical gift to the glory of God? When you bring all these instruments in, I want to give you a quick sample of the music that you're going to be hearing. Take a listen.
you've been delivered. Do you know Jesus is Lord of all here? Is he Lord of all in your life?
That's just the tip of the iceberg, guys. Now, the way I'm wanting to put this together is this. This person has already taken the time to put together a whole bunch of short clips of these songs. I'm going to be adding more clips as I find time. The way it's going to be presented is this. If you hear a song that you don't like, just wait about 20 seconds and the next song will play. If you hear a song that you do like, you can look at the screen and the name of the artist that's singing it and the name of the song will be there on the screen. Remember, these are just little clips of the song. So if you find something you like, look at the screen. It'll tell you who's singing it and what the name of the song is. And because the copyrights on these songs should be expired by now, it's been 35, 40 years, somewhere in that area, they should be expired by now. You may be able to go online, maybe even on YouTube, and find the entire song. And I'm telling you, some of these songs will move you. Some of them will make you cry. Some of them will motivate you. I know for me, when I was growing up, it really helped me in my faith. It really helped out. It really helped keep me on the straight and narrow to hear these songs in these multiple different styles that brought glory to the Lord. And what I want to do is I want to share it with you guys. And that's what the next 11 videos are going to do. And what I want to do is just continue with the pattern that this person started. I will start with the 1979 songs. And if I have any music in my collection from 1979, I'll just add it to the clip collection. And then the next video will be the music that was famous, the contemporary Christian music that was famous in the 1980. And then the next one will be 1981. And then the next will be right up. And you're going to hear so many different musical styles and types and bands and groups. You're liable to find some new songs you've never heard before, new artists you've never heard before. Sadly, some of these artists have passed away, but they left the music behind for us. And since the radio won't play them anymore, I'm happy that YouTube is still around, to where at least people can get a little segment of these songs, and maybe in some cases the whole song. So guys, this is the introductory video, and I'm going to get to work right now to start putting together the music presentations, the clips of these songs, and start posting them for you. Just hope that YouTube doesn't flag the video because of the songs. I'm not sure why they will, because it's up other places on YouTube, so hopefully they won't flag it for me. But I want to share it with you guys, because I really care about you guys, and I want it to be that you can get rid of all that old music they gave you in the cult, and you can now have music that is powerful, strong, giving praise to Jesus, giving praise to the Father, giving praise to the Holy Spirit, lifting up God's holy word, building you up in the faith. That's what I like to do. So guys, I'm going to get to editing this here, get it down, get all the stuff in there that's needed, and get this stuff up there for y'all. So wish me the best. I look forward to seeing your comments, and I'll try to make another video soon if I can. Good night, everybody.